high school floor had been talking to myself.
Your son's great, huh?
I'm starting to get off with some public comment. Anybody here like to take a moment and have the floor? Very good. Let's move on to our meeting notes. You should have our committee notes from the March 12th meeting. Take a look at them at your convenience. Let Mr. Mariani know if you see any discrepancies, and we will clean those up for you. We don't need to approve them, but we do want to make sure we try to keep them accurate. Why don't we dive right into our reports? Steve, you want to start off for Andrew?
Certainly. This report takes us through week 13 of this year. Our radio calls are up about 92 over the case of last year. That's a stat we watch closely because obviously the more time on radio calls, the less proactive patrol. So we did an analysis to see when do we get these calls. As we see that Monday and Tuesday are our busiest days, followed closely by Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. A slight drop off on Saturday, and then Sunday a huge drop off. So it's just interesting we use that with our planning our deployment. A lot of interesting things went on the last period. On the 24th of March, our bike officers were flagged down in Hollywood and Vine by a group of people. They said there was a major incident going on at Sunset and Vine. So we've had some major incidents there before. For instance, that shooter there from the area. So they didn't know what to expect as they held up to the scene. And what they found was a man banging on the windshield of an MTA bus. The bus driver was terrified in there. The interesting thing was the man was 85 years old. He was incensed because the bus stop had moved. So we were able to gently get him to a curb and show him another bus stop. He was still mad, but of course he's diverted and a major incident was resolved. We had another incident at the Jack in the Box. We had a call of a woman refusing to leave. This woman was 45 to 50, about 6'1" and 300 pounds. When we got there, she was screaming obscenities at the employees because they were refusing her service. So these are the kind of situations, very volatile. We could arrest her for trespassing. We certainly didn't want to be arresting and going to the ground. So one of our officers, Charles Mooney, was able to establish a rapport with her. He managed to go outside and talk to him. He actually took her money and went in and bought his food for her. The employee did not want to give him the food because he was mad because he's human and she'd been screaming about him and his mother and whatnot. But we prevailed. We're going to solve this problem. We don't want this woman here. She doesn't want to be here. We bought her the food, took it out, and we pretty much she would eat it elsewhere. So that's the kind of stuff we try to teach our officers, and it was very effective there. Our officers are trained that somebody can get a report, and the other step back, and then one step forward. You can see here we attended 17 meetings this period. That's with law enforcement, the business community, and the outreach community. And simply, that's how we extend our influence as we represent you and coordinate the sharing of resources towards improving the quality of life in the biz. Homeless outreach is one of our major functions. Once again, not as enablers, but as problem solvers. Our unarmed officers met a woman named Jessica on foot patrol. She had just become homeless along with her two dogs. We're always looking for historical data. Carrie has encouraged us to try to find out why do people become homeless? Why did they come here? Jessica was fleeing an abusive boyfriend. Her goals were to return to Chicago. The officers bought her a couple of cheeseburgers and gave her the information that could lead to that for getting the transportation. Also during this month, we've been talking to a man named Arnie. Arnie, you may remember, he was on our streets, severely mentally ill, very violent. He would follow women, literally walking one inch behind and breathing on their neck, follow young girls and stuff down the boulevard. It was very volatile. We had to arrest him several times. Carrie's leadership, the entire outreach community, made a project with him. We were a big part of it. We were actually the ones that documented him displaying that he was a danger to himself and others. We were ultimately able to get him into a conservatorship for a year where he was on the proper medication and treatment. He's back on the street now. The outreach community has determined that he won't fall between the cracks. In fact, a group called Housing Works has contacted me, so please keep an eye on him. If you see any of him slipping back into the hallways, they'll respond immediately. In fact, they called me last week. They have an apartment for him, asked us to locate him, and of course, we know where Arnie is daily, and we were able to direct the counselor to him. So the important thing of the story is that the outreach community trusts us as a partner. We're not the enemy of the homeless. We're actually a partner in these sort of issues. Going on to page three. Our officers also spoke to a man named Andrew on the 6200 block of Leland Way. As you know, early in the morning, we wake people up. Andrew explained to our officers he had a bad night and he actually soiled himself. And it's just a matter of, you know, common decency. He, now he'll be forced to walk around, you know, with soiled clothes. Our officers went to the Church of the Blessed Sacrament, the center. Spencer, you know, was only too happy to supply a holding wardrobe. Took him back to Andrew, and so he can, you know, keep his self-respect. He goes through the day, not wearing soiled clothing. And we made another friend that day. Much less likely to be a problem for us, so we have a relationship. In the interest of time, I'm going to skip right past page four and go to five. Enforcement, of course, is one of our other means of improving the quality of life. You can read through the stats if you want. They're broken down by bid and the totals. But a couple of the interesting arrests, we got a call of them to enable the music. Security there was trying to hold down a man who had committed a theft against fighting them. We asked them to call LAPD, which they did. When we arrived, there was an LAPD sergeant there alone. He was handling the one situation, and an uninvolved party then climbed into the officer's patrol car. So this was chaotic. Our officers were able to help the sergeant get control of the situation and just provide security until LAPD arrived in force just a minute later. Our officers were at the Goodwill store, 1218 Vine. The security guard approached and pointed out a man named Thomas. Said he had robbed us earlier. We realize our role, we're not the police, we're security. The man Thomas left, two of our officers followed him, one stayed behind at Goodwill. LAPD arrived and we were able to guide them to where the suspect was and they made the arrest for Robert. So that's our model whenever possible. Our officers also were at Hollywood and Vine, were flagged down by a sheriff motor officer. And a homeless man was chasing a tourist, female tourist around with a hypodermic syringe. That's a very scary situation. So we were able to stand by and help him control the man. We got witness statements. LAPD arrived, and their officers determined this man had some severe mental illness issues, and they placed a 5150 hold, and he was taken to the hospital for evaluation. And then one other interesting story on the 12th, our officer spoke to a homeless man that we know as Shreds. He told us that a man who dresses in a Spider-Man costume at Hollywood Highland had a gun today. The man also dresses as Mickey Mouse. I became concerned because this man had been on the boulevard earlier that day passing out literature about President Obama. It was very strange, disturbing type of stuff, things that you might read on the internet, on blogs sometimes. And so I contacted Captain Zarconi, and he, as far as I can tell, just left right into the case, contacted Secret Service. And before I knew it, they had identified the guy, located him. We were searching, we couldn't find him. LAPD somehow found him, and luckily he had a few warrants. They were able to get him off the street. And the concern was because the president was actually here that day, filming Jimmy Kimmel. So I left that out, but that's why we were really concerned. And they were able to get him off the street, and we all just kind of had a sigh of relief and went about the day. Our deployment during this period remained the same, 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. Monday through Saturday, 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. on Sunday, and our officers received training in emergency guidelines, sexual harassment, and legal update. Thank you.
Any questions for Andrew? All right, thank you, Steve. Let's move on to our partner reports, trends, and observations for March. Cap, do you want to take it?
Yeah, sure. I'm going to turn over to Ozzie in a second, but okay. In broad terms, I'm sure everybody's aware that legislative changes in the last few years, including AB1 and most recently Prop 47, there are necessarily going to be more violators that would otherwise be locked up that are no longer locked up. We are definitely feeling the impact of that citywide. It's not imaginary, it's real. Citywide, years to date, violent crime is up about 28%. Hollywood, we're doing a little bit better, but it's still up 23%. So that's a pretty big jump in violent crime. Property crime is up about 9% in Hollywood, and total Park 1 combined is at right at about 11.6%. But those numbers are disturbing. We're doing everything that we can to try to keep them down, but obviously, with increased increase numbers of violators out there, the number of violations go up, it's just common sense. On the bright side, those numbers are still 45% lower than 10 years ago. So we're not back to the worst we've been, we're still better. We're, you know, we're definitely fearful as a city that, these legislative changes are going to kind of hamstring the point. Answer is simple, or we lose one of the games. I hope that doesn't happen. And definitely can, with your partnership to try to keep the lid on the Hollywood. A couple special events coming up. This Saturday, we've got Hollywood Happy Marathon. And then the following Saturday will be the West Hollywood After Marathon, which is going to actually come to Hollywood for about 2 miles on Sunset. And then on 24th, we've got a very large observance of the Armenian genocide. It's the 100-year anniversary of that event. For that reason, the Armenian community expects to have a very huge what's normally a small march in Little Armenia and Hollywood, and then disbands and then picks up the Turkish consulate for a small rally and protest there. It's going to be morphed into a very large rally in Hollywood. March all the way to the Turkish consulate. Large rally. They're expecting about 15,000 people to visit as well. That is on the 24th, which is Friday.
Where's Turkish consulate?
It's on Wilshire Boulevard, over by Crescent Heights. So they'll basically go down Sunset to La Brea, down La Brea. It's Wilshire.
Wow. That's good.
So it'll be huge. If that Friday would be a good day to be off. That's all I got. I'll be adding.
Yeah, just, just kind of piggyback on the captain's numbers. The good thing is that HED crime is down 10.32% as opposed to last year. So I'll go over some numbers real quick. For this 1 week extraction period from 329 to 04-2015, we had 19 part one times in HED, which accounted for 23.75% of the 80 crimes in Hollywood area. So if you look at the year-to-date numbers, or last year we were at 329, this year we're at 295 part one crimes, so that accounts for a reduction in 10.3% of part one crimes. So, some of the things that Captain Tractoni has implemented is that has been effective, and you guys have been out there, is the use of the slammer van. We try to deploy that when we can, on the weekends especially. We deploy a plainclothes unit, and they're monitoring Hollywood and Las Palmas for people who are intoxicated, potential fights, and there's a zero tolerance on the boulevard. So if they're drunk, and they can't care for themselves, or they're likely to be a potential suspect or a victim in some cases, we're taking them off the street, and so that we can kind of protect those people and others. The other thing that is a constant challenge, we did have 2 weekends ago a traffic accident where a person had left the home. And I don't have all the particulars, so I apologize. But they're coming down the boulevard, and he ended up striking a pedestrian on the boulevard. The pedestrian was a tourist. The last time I had heard, he is still in critical condition. He has not passed. I believe it was at Hollywood and Whitney over in that area.
That's where it was. We initially, it was reported that he was expired, but he was revived and he's still in the office.
So some of the resources that we're looking for from the department is the West Traffic Division. They have a motor saturation control unit that comes and helps us tremendously. So we've been deploying them on the weekend as well as our officers. So they made some significant progress in that. As opposed to the, or going back to the homeless issue, I actually responded to the Ivar and Sunset incident that Andrews helped us tremendously. I actually did the use of force investigation on that. And I'd like to comment again that your people were extremely professional. I interviewed some of the witnesses, and it definitely corroborated the partnership and all the stuff that we talked about here and all the stuff that Captain Tractoni impressed us about. So our officers were, and the sergeant was very happy to see your guys come help them. So thank you for that. Some of the training that we have coming up this Friday, we have, I think I talked about it before, we have what we call is an ACE, it's an alternative citation enforcement. And it's another form of citation that we're using in lieu of the release from custody. So if the officers determine that they have a good address, good identification, then we're giving them, in a sense, administrative citation. So somebody who might be visiting Los Angeles, who might be committing a LAMC violation, we're issuing them a citation. They pretty much get similar to what a parking citation would be. They get it in the mail, they want to contest it, they have to pay it up front, and it goes to collections. So that's another thing that we're using to try to help reduce some of the aggravated assaults. The homeless issue is a constant challenge for me, and I know we've talked about it. The little small 2x4 cards that Captain Zarconian had made up for the area. The officers carry these. We use them as a form of getting resources and help for these people. We haven't had much success with people wanting help. And unfortunately, we've had success in either getting them to do what we need them to do. In some situations, they do have outstanding warrants, so we're required to arrest them in those things. But hopefully, we can kind of build on that momentum. I know that the officers, we are tracking that. I don't have the exact numbers, but the next meeting, I'll tell you how many we've actually issued out and how many arrests we have. And then lastly, the neighborhood prosecutor, Jackie Lawson, is actually coming this Friday, I believe, to do more training on those things to help us out. And then the crime strategy that we're implementing, we do have a kind of similar to this map. We have a crime mission map that's given to the guys in HUD and the other officers on different watches. And we basically push the Captain Zarconian's mission and what he prioritized to be important. So for this week, it's aggravated assaults and robberies. We've had some robberies on the boulevard, and as much as I want to reduce them, we've had some success, and the officers are in the right place at the right time. Some of the significant arrests that we've made have been a citizen flag down. So the officers are out there, we're arresting them, and we're hopefully trying to get successful prosecution.
Is there a pattern to time of day that's happening?
They're relatively in the I would say, about 10 o'clock p.m. to about 2:30. Sometimes the clubs do attract some of those things. That's why we are using the zero tolerance in those areas.
And are those thefts from motor vehicles primarily, or those snatch and grab purses? Or?
Yeah, those cell phones actually. You guys pulling up, seeing those cell phones, jumping out, grabbing out. Yeah, so.
Don't text and walk.
Yeah, so.
I'm thinking we need to give our projector to Devin, who's going downtown, and I was thinking we'd show the pictures from the midnight walk a few weeks ago. Sergeant Robbins was really helpful in the Sierra, and you know, getting us acclimated, or eight of us out there, and it might touch upon some of these evening conditions.
Okay.
So if we can show that, if we relinquish the machine in a minute.
Absolutely.
Oh my gosh, no, absolutely not. So, to tee this up, 8 people went out on the night before the marathon. Bob Gray was there, Bill Ferrar,
if you don't
Steve
know.
Seiler, myself, Jeff Saranat, LaRon, Alyssa Van Dane, who's a new board member for the bid, so any of you guys can chime in. We are part of the slideshow, the chamber,
Jeff
Saranat. The Chamber has the retreat this weekend, and I know this is going to be a topic of conversation. We have two groups. We started at the, half of it started at the Roosevelt and walked east past Starkland, took the subway down to Hollywood and Vine, and walked west, and we met at Las Palmas, basically, at 1:45, so we could witness the push, which was one of the big objectives for the evening. So this was... we're noticing Kashmir has reopened. This is in Benny Ballard's building. The guy, it's Marlton, Steve Marlton, it's a club that many of the clubs that he's been involved with have not been particularly well managed. This is a very unruly crowd. And this was probably right around 1215, 1200 or so. This, you know, the bouncers didn't have a particularly good handle on people wanting to get in. we got down to the corner of Los Palmas and Hollywood, and this, of course, is the core place of a lot of our issues right now. You can see how crowded that sidewalk is, and one of the issues we have there is seven businesses in a row, starting with the Los Palmas Supper Club, and then there's the, now it's called the, Spanish name. No. I'm talking about on the Los Palmas side. It's Toros Locos. And then you got Rusty Mullet, and then you're going to have like Jameson's and Palo Cantina, and then eventually you'll get to Ed's Supper Club. Eventually you get to Loose on the far end of that. But you can just see the how crowded the sidewalks are there. Again, people are coming out into the street. This is in front of Jameson. One of the things that it's very noticeable, and you see it here, a few of the businesses there have their windows are open to the sidewalk, and you've got people who are just hanging out on the sidewalk, hanging out. They're watching the televisions. There's dozens and dozens of screens there. So even if you're not in there to take advantage of the restaurant or the club, the activity is really on the sidewalk, and I know that's been the source of some of the problems. This is, again, in front of Rusty Mullet. Is it Lieutenant?
Sergeant Ward.
Sergeant Ward, okay. He was kind of briefing us on how they're doing crowd control. Fabio.
That's good.
Yeah. We were going to try to go into the Supper Club, which we did 2 years ago, but was determined to be too crowded, and Danny had, I guess, put the call out to not let anybody else in, so it's not really considered a safe place for us to go. This is looking, this is in front of Palo Cantina, looking west. And again, it's probably about, I would say, 1 a.m. at this point. Another view, another camera, a lot of emergency response out there. My sense of Hollywood Boulevard at night is a lot of sirens, a lot of paramedics, a lot of noise. Not a particularly desirable place for any of us to be walking around. This is down, we kept walking, this is in front of Jane's house. Still a lot of activity, but the crowd was a little bit more manageable, I would say. But there's, I don't know, five establishments, I think, in that particular property. And then down at Hollywood Vine Folks, I think things were a little bit calmer down there, and they went into Avalon and walked past the place on Argyle. Have you done that with Fabio?
No, I was on the other side.
Yes. True Hollywood.
True, yeah.
It used to be true.
It used to be a problem, but I think it was better than it was a couple years ago. And our group walked all the way back on Selma so that we could get to Los Palmas by 1:45. And what we observed on Selma and actually parts of Coalinga was actually a good vibe, a much calmer crowd, something that you actually would see in Boston or Philadelphia or parts of New York. These are all people in front of the piano bar on Selma. When we get back, I was noticing that the marathon was the next day, so there were signs parked all along Hollywood Boulevard that, of course, cars were going to start being towed. And you can imagine the confusion that that caused. A lot of people did not see those signs. So basically what we had was just a plethora of cars being towed, which I don't know that impacted people when they came out later at night looking for the cars, but it was a big night for Hollywood Tow. Party bus. And so here we are getting ready for the push. And obviously Supper Club is the ground zero for that, because what, 1,200 people come out of there at 2 a.m.? 1,500 people?
CP says 650 or something.
So what we did is we went up on a rooftop. And what is different about this as compared to a couple years ago, and I have to commend Captain Zarconi for this, because Bill and I saw this 2 years ago, and when the board went out, the Hollywood board, the traffic used to be still going, and as people came out of the clubs, there were these barricades, and people were being kind of like scrunched up against the barricades to protect them from the vehicles. And it just, to me, it always seemed like it was just a disaster waiting to happen. You just get one person who trips and falls, and now you've got a mob. So now LAPD is basically functioning as DOT and doing a lot of traffic control to prepare for this and keep people safe. I don't know if you want to mention anything about that strategy.
It's just that it's the overall congestion that doesn't thin out, and when we don't do that, what happens is the crowd will linger because the vehicles will keep cruising looking for, hey, where are people congregating, where is there a party? So it's really a tactic not only to mitigate traffic, but to also get people to realize, okay, time to go.
It's time to go, yeah.
So that's really what the purpose of it is. It is pretty effective. It's not perfect, but it's...
It just demonstrates, though, the amount of law enforcement resources to control just a couple of folks. This is a little, let me see, this is a little bit. One of the board members who shared her observations with me, she thought it was very well controlled, but she said, if you were a visitor to Hollywood Boulevard on a particular weekend night, you would think you had entered a police station. Here's our group. All right. I guess one more video, but no, that's okay. You get the idea. So, Fabio, you had never done this before.
Yeah, I've done it yet.
Yeah.
Oh, I love calmer. I love different. You can see this, you know, but still a little bit worrisome. I think this would have too much. Basically, 2 o'clock, I was feeling that there's the calm before the storm.
I had a little different observation as opposed to the police state. To me, it was a comfort seeing officers all over the place and very responsive. And I think that makes all the average person feel a lot better seeing them. You know? And I think it's necessary.
I agree. I think her comment was, this is what we have to do every weekend night to be an entertainment district. That's kind of not sustainable. That area is a challenge for us, and you know, the future vision of Las Palmas cannot be a place where every night the cops have to stop the traffic. And there needs to be a transformation of the business model.
But those are those like three blocks, because as you mentioned, Selma has a very quiet vibe, relaxed, and it's Selma, Owenga. Those 2 blocks are really feeling this tension.
And, you know, just sort of looking at it from a root cause, you know, if we don't give Adolfo 6 liquor licenses in every building that he owns, you know, which he does every single time he buys a building, he goes and applies for, you know, his ridiculous amount of liquor licenses. And the whole building is just serving booze, and he's trying to do the same thing right now at Hudson, right next to the, you know, what used to be the Hillview. He owns that building on the corner. He's trying to, you know, all the way up Hudson, which is like adjacent to all the multifamily up there. There's that's a tiny little street that's been packed with bodies. Jane's house is his, so, you know, it's no coincidence that all of these spots where there's way too many people are there's a saturation of liquor licenses.
This hearing, this doesn't really show up in the news.
Of course.
You do. Because I went to that, it was, you know, they told me the police will be here.
The bottom line is, what we're trying to do is we're talking about transforming the character of the boulevard and what it's supposed to be. It's been very nightclub-centric for a long time, and that did help the economy, you know, there's no doubt about it, but what we're hoping to morph into is more sane type of nightlife, restaurant oriented. So when liquor licenses are, for instance, on the property on Hudson we're talking about, there was a request for multiple 48s.
Right.
And like equal number 48s and 47s. We kind of got them to scale that back to all 47s, the 148 being one of the Houston properties or something. That's still not approved yet for them. The bottom line is the liquor licenses that are being approved are coming with restrictions to make them be a real restaurant, because restaurants don't make money on the so that people may be, so that you can close the midnight.
Right, hours of operation, yeah.
So we'll be very strict on hours of operation, what they're allowed to do.
That's great.
Give them a restaurant license, the ability to have a dance floor.
Sure.
And music, they're not gonna be a restaurant, they're gonna be a club.
Right.
And, so we're not letting them do that, so we're just being very smart about.
Good.
How we figure the 47 licenses that we can say yes to. And even if we say no to something, that's just a recommendation.
Right, so the CA.
It goes to zoning administrator, and then the zoning administrator gives their recommendation, but the ABC has the ultimate authority to say you get that license or not. If ABC grants a license, ABC grants a license, that's the state of California. But they're, so far, we've been very successful in arguing for the restrictions that we want, and we've been getting.
Good.
Yeah, is there any way that these people can lose their license through violations?
It's not very easy.
Considering how many of these.
It takes a lot of violations to be serious. Problem is, it's incremental enforcement, so you start out with a small fine. So you have to really focus on one to get it all the way to the point where you're going to be able to affect the laws.
And that's like years, right?
Yeah, it's really manpower.
Carrie, has the bid gone through the hearings at all? You don't get involved in that?
We don't, but we should disseminate the information.
I understand the conflict though, because the bid is.
Yeah.
The chamber.
Their property owners, their business, and they domain, they all that.
So chamber property?
Chambers.
The writing will do.
Chambers.
Okay, then we'll bring it up.
Yeah, and then I'm a huge supporter of us taking a neutral position on all of those things, depth development or liquor licenses or any of those issues. But I do think that we should disseminate the information of when the hearings are to anybody and everybody, so that if you're the next door neighbor and you're concerned.
And you don't know that it's in here.
That's really the role of neighborhood councils today. I mean, they're pretty on top of that issue, so the neighborhood councils, if you get the word out.
Good.
Have these hearings, I found.
Yeah. Okay. Anything else on that front, Carrie?
No, I just wanted you to see the images. I know it's going to be a key priority of discussion.
Do we have already time for that?
So Ron and I are having lunch after this meeting.
Okay.
And Joe's going to be at the chamber retreat this weekend, and we'll get the slides for you.
Just briefly, there's a Times article today, I can send out to you, about bars and nightclubs in Los Angeles. And what the writer essentially says is that there should be more bars and less regulations, because areas like Westwood and other areas where they're only allowed to have like two bars, this whole entire area, it overpopulates areas like Hollywood and other parts of the city to meet the demand. And so if we had more bars, that's his theory. But I'll send it out.
Is it an op-ed piece?
Yeah, so I'll send it out. I just got it. I'll tell you, I literally just got it on my phone. Yeah, it's worth reading. It's a good one.
Steve Balls and
probably. Right. Anyways, I'll send that out to the committee though.
And so on that particular night, we had no violent crime reported. And on some of the clubs that are on Hollywood Boulevard, without compromising any of the investigation, they are no radar. We did meet with a supper club about doing the lines and that stuff. So we do have a system in place that has been working these last couple of weekends. So although that is important to us, keep these people excited about it. We have a system in place, hopefully that'll work.
And we saw that. And I don't want this to be a criticism. I would like to see us in a place where we don't have to be.
No, I totally.
Like it used to be on Antolinga, and now Antolinga. There's hope. It can happen.
Yeah.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, LAPD. Sheriff, anything to report in the subway?
Well, I got information. I saw your email.
Yeah.
No trends. It's just an ongoing level of crime that happens on the red line. Do you know what time? She sent an email out.
I'll tee you up a little bit. So it was just passing along. We have a staff person who rides, new staff person who rides the subway exclusively, comes up in Koreatown. And in the last month has experienced three incidents that led him to call the, you know, the emergency call either on the train or on the platform. Three assaults, and they were during commute time at 7 a.m. So, you know, I asked, you know, is there a trend, kind of like what Captain Zarconi is noticing? Is something happening? Is this, you know, and I didn't want to make it about him, but, you know, we just don't know relative to how things were a year ago or 2 years ago. Are there some trends happening with respect to assaults on the platform?
No, no trend. It's about the same as it was a year ago. What we have been doing, started focusing on it less than a year ago, was the sleepers that get on the trains when it opens up for service in the morning, and they camp out on the trains. And I think this was discussed in the prior meeting. We're focusing more on North Hollywood and Union Station, waking them up. So we got maybe half the deputies that start at 5 in the morning are at these two locations. When the train comes in, we're going on the trains, we're sweeping the trains, waking people up, and there's a small percentage that don't want to go with the program and want to take somebody to jail. And it's a big deal, because it looks like quite a few of them, you know, caused a lot of the problems that we see in the mornings. Because they, you know, one person takes up two seats, and the train gets full of commuters, and all that happens. So, as far as her riding and not seeing deputies around, there might be, from Union Station to North Hollywood, there might be 16 trains going both directions at one time, and then maybe another 6 to 8 going between Union and Wilshire Western. And they're starting at 5, there might be 6 deputies starting the shift. One or two deputies getting off the early morning shift. And at 7 o'clock, there might be 4 more deputies getting on shift and focusing on the ends of the lines. She might not see a deputy riding the train. She might pass by deputies that are in a static position. So, you know, it's just, that's by chance. So.
And then the assaults, what's the profile of these people just getting into fights, or somebody trying to steal cell phones like TV was talking about? Is there any sort of a pattern that you see with these assaults?
Well, usually if it's the theft of a property, like cell phone, or something like that, it looks like most people report those, so they usually turn into robberies. But other people, like sleepers or those kind of people, transient types that get on there, they just seem to be angry.
Mentally ill.
Yeah. Looking for a fight.
Yeah.
And I don't know that so many of those get reported, like a robbery or theft. So. But yeah, there's a certain percentage of the patrons that don't pay, and there's a type that's likely to be fighting.
Okay, any questions for the sheriffs? Thank you.
Yeah.
No Jackie today, so we'll skip the city attorney's office. Dan is not here either. We will reach out to you again at the next meeting. And then, do you want to take out another 5 staff statement requests?
I just thought I would share, I kind of have to run a list of the kinds of things that we get called about. I realize we get great reports that can only be in with patrol and sheriffs, et cetera. And one of the things that I feel a little frustrated about in this job is I don't think some of our stakeholders and even board members know how many calls we get to try to solve problems that you never even know about. There's a lot of stuff we do behind the scenes to try to tackle issues, and we get phone calls from our stakeholders. And we rely on LAPD or the council office or other folks to help us. But it's a constant balancing act to know, how do we prioritize our time and how do we try to be responsive. So just like in the last month I was making a list, we have a kind of recurring problem right now with the LA County Courthouse property being, it's right here actually, right behind us. It's going to be under construction soon. They have a very porous chain link fence, which has created encampments. It's created problems for Galvin's property, which people coming into the alley is directly adjacent, and it's been tagged multiple times. And we have tried to work with the state to get the graffiti painted out on Gallo's property. He's a property stakeholder. And then the state will say you need to have an insurance certificate to enter the lot where there's people sleeping. But for us to go in and paint someone's wall, we can't get in without an insurance certificate. So I'm not going to tell you how we solve these things, but it's like the day in the life. Another issue is the Sharpie's Alley continues to be an area of our focus where we're trying to encourage those neighbors to work together to agree to some kind of a gate to avoid the ability of dumping and graffiti and the homeless. We had a homeless man die there last year. We also brought Scientology into the discussion because they have what appears to be a illegal concrete wall that they put into that alley. So, we're bringing the neighbors together. Got an angry call from Tony Cooper, who runs Red Line Tours. He operates out of the lobby of the Egyptian Theater, and we're just concerned about the transients in the bid, which we're going to talk about in a moment. What are you doing about this? It's got worse. I'm doing walking tours of Hollywood Boulevard. Just so many people lobbying our tourists. Right here at Gower in Hollywood, Paul from property owner concerned about, and I saw them today as I walked here, there's a group of people, rather intimidating, who gather there almost daily. I know that there actually were some arrests there recently of some of those folks. There's like an older guy who's a green leader with a bunch of younger people. And one of the things we are going to do is, the property owner wanted us to remove the trees. That's how desperate it is. We take out those trees because they're camping out in the shade of the trees. We are going to trim those trees, we can at least do that, and try to address that. But that's an issue. The Crest continues to become a gathering point for a group of folks. I know this was discussed in crime control this week.
In the front or the back?
The front. And we have had a heck of a time trying to get the property owner to sign a trespass
form. Yeah, yesterday.
We did. Okay. So.
You got it?
And that's kind of what it takes. We've been working for months. That's Dr. Wood's property to get the property owner to agree because they sit on a ledge and gather with their dogs and intimidate walkers by. Got a call from Eldo Swaya, concerned about transients on Hudson. And what are we going to do about that? And then finally, Jack in the Box has kind of surfaced again as an issue. So the way we do this stuff is we problem solve also. We're going to have a meeting with the regional manager of Jack in the Box, their head of security, LAPD, hopefully will be there. It will be in 2 weeks. They don't have a security come in now until 11 in the morning. And because they're open super early, we're in there all the time. And that's not what the bid was set up to do, is to be a private security for a business. So that's just 1 month's worth of problem solving. And I'm just sharing this with some of the board members because, I know that we have people who feel like we're not solving all these problems in a bid, but they are not really within our control, and they require a lot of shepherding and marshaling and coalition building to
Well, the Sharky's always a perfect example. We can't do anything there until the property owners.
So they work together.
Yeah, it's there. It's an easement. It's there. They actually own the real estate. So it's not our job to go clean their back of their house every day.
Right. And a lot of these do involve property owners taking control. We cannot be, we cannot solve their problems for them. Even the press, we send pictures to the owner like, this is what's happening and you are impacting this entire block by not addressing this. And even the property owner at Gower in Hollywood was complaining that Uber drivers are parking in his parking lot, taking parking spaces away from like the legitimate customers at night. Like, that's really not the biggest problem. You probably could get a security guard or have some kind of parking system, but we cannot solve the Uber.
You've got to tell your own person about this problem. Okay, thank you. We've talked about our report for the Midnight Walk. Moving on to new business, Andrew's Dispatch discussion.
Yes, so we have been in discussions, staff and Andrew's management team, for a couple of months about the need and the recommendation on their part, and I support this, to add a professional dispatcher to the office at Hollywood Highland. And I think it kind of correlates with some of the things we're hearing, increasing violent interactions with people who really are concerned about officer safety and ensuring that our guides are protected. And I went in and met with our team about 3 weeks ago, which I try to do, not often enough. They're just like, tell me what's going on, what's on your mind, what are the hot buttons in the bid? And they were very emphatic that they wanted to have a professional dispatcher during the busy times of the week. So just, I want to just give you just a little background on this. We can do this within the existing budget, but because it is a little bit of a change, I want you to be aware of it. Basically, right now, what we've had in that office is Steve and Joe, and then we've had like an administrative assistant, Vicki, who's there 40 hours a week, and she would handle the calls, or is handling the calls right now. On the weekends, you know, there's a different permutation of Joe is there on Saturdays, and on Sundays, which is a lighter day, our officer, the supervisor in charge, will actually handle calls, or if he's out in the field, he'll come in on his cell phone. So what they're proposing is that on our weekdays, we would hire a professional dispatcher who will work Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. And the existing team will fill in around that person. So in the mornings, Vicki, the current person, will handle those calls from 7 to 10. And then Joe will handle the calls in the evening until 8 p.m. And they will work as they're currently working on the weekends. Sunday is a very little call day. One of the things that we have noticed is that the call volume has increased. You know, ever since this, to show you the increase, ever since 2007, when Andrew started handling our bid operation, the call volume
is that yearly?
Yeah, 2007 to 2014. So we're up to last year was a banner, 2013 was a banner year of about 5,000 calls into the bid office.
There's never been a dispatcher in. How about the bird for that?
They had the guy, what was his name?
5,000 calls.
They basically had an officer sitting in the office and answer calls.
Yeah, that's like the supervisor just sit there and answer calls all day. It was never as busy as it's got. And what happens now is that these guys, Vicki is not able to handle her admin load, so Steve and Joe are handling administrative tasks, and they're not freed up to be out in the field supervising, problem solving, having more visibility. So the other thing that our guys are concerned about is that if there's an officer needs help call, they're not entirely sure that it's being heard, if she's busy doing something else. And also a professional dispatcher would, if she hasn't heard from them in a while, she would check up on them. So it was a pretty emphatic request. I heard them. The budget amount would be $38,000 a year, which we would divide between the two bids, 34% to Sunset, 66% to Hollywood. And it fits within the budget because we ended with both bids last year. We had a positive variance in both bid budgets, so we
fit it in. Seems like a logical use of funds, 5,000 calls.
Do we need a motion? You know, I view this as something that can be done with an existing budget, but we don't do motions in this committee. So if it's, you know, that I'm not quite good. I mean, we could do it with an abundance of caution next week. We could say, granted by the security committee, they agree.
Anybody have a problem with it?
No, but I will run it. You know, had to get just make sure.
I agree.
So we might be about a week away from getting this.
Yahoo. Okay, so next on the agenda is the potential addition of a Las Palmas camera. Joe?
Yeah, we just, I had reported that we've been working with Metro on getting some quotes for some other locations. And talking with Carrie last week and with the LAPD and the captain, I think it seems like a logical spot for us to put the next camera would be all over Las Palmas. So Metro went out there, Jim was our representative, and it looks like we'd be placing it on the northwest corner there by the Outpost building, which I think is a great shot because we would be able to see east and see kind of the strip clubs that are all there on the east side of that intersection.
Yeah.
And then a little bit west and south as well, so you can see where Sadie and Sam is and everything like that.
On his building or on?
It's going to be on the LADOT pole. So
right.
That's another thing that would hopefully, ideally, we're going to work with the council office to see if they can help expedite it. Because sometimes we're working with a private property owner and trying to get some of their buildings a little difficult. So we got the quote, it's $14,266.38. The equipment's about $8,000 and the labor's around $5,500. Like Carrie said, we won't take a motion, but just kind of bringing it here, we'll bring it for the Hollywood one since this camera will be in the Hollywood bid and see if they'll approve it at the board meeting next week. Jim said he would be able to probably start work on it. He's a little slammed right now, but most likely by early June because he has to come out here to do the lending on the camera. So also installing a camera so we're going to go to park for LAPD. So he thinks he can tie it into his work at that time.
Great, and then you, where's the repeater for that?
So now with this new system, you don't have to worry as much because these little nodes that they're putting up are already kind of essentially building this mesh network that we kind of talked about.
Right.
So when they put up the node on the pole for this camera, it would actually bounce off of the Cahuenga building at the northeast corner of Cahuenga. So that's its line of sight and then they're back to the station. So we don't need to hit the media center anymore.
Great.
Would it be a better location, the south west corner? So, because the clubs are Las Palmas and Hollywood. I'm looking at it like I don't think we'd be able to see all the four or five bars on the north side of Hollywood. That's where the trouble is not.
We can ask him if that's even feasible. I think he just kind of looked at it and he usually picks whatever's feasible. So I'll double check and see if there was a problem why we couldn't do the southwest. But essentially, there's an LADOT pole there. We can do it. I think why, and just recalling my conversation with him yesterday, the reason why he's chosen the northwest corner is because you have to have whatever the electrical box is on, whatever corner that's at, that's where you can get access to the pole because that's where they can run the lines. And the box for that intersection is on the northwest corner. So that's why they're tying it into there. But I can ask still if there's a way that it can be feasible to do it on the southwest.
You see?
Yeah, I know what
you're
saying.
Better on the south?
Yeah. Although you do get. You know, we've had our times in the past where the Sound nightclub and Sadie's back when it was the Dew was pretty crazy down there. And if that lights up again, it might be the location of Tim's Donuts.
I mean, if you couldn't do the southwest, I think it's probably the next best corner that you can do on that intersection. I'm looking at it every day. But to follow this point, I can check and see. But I think it's the reason being is that the electrical box is there.
Okay.
The last thing to pass this out, I think we talked briefly at the last committee meeting and it was discussed at both boards. But there was a bill introduced in late February called the Right to Rest Act, SB 608, by Senator Carol Liu, who represents the area around Monterey Park. And this bill is the son of the old Bill of Rights, ABO 5, 2 years ago. And basically, it says that any individual has the right to pretty much live on the public right of way with no time limit, with no limit on number of people there, even limit on the activities that they would carry out, regardless of their housing status. And there was a pretty swift response statewide. Of all the bids, at least, we had about four conference calls to prepare for the hearing, which was Tuesday in Sacramento at the Transportation and Housing Committee. And apparently, there was a major rally of homeless advocates in Sacramento prior to the hearing. This is a bill that has been proposed by the Western Regional Advocacy Center, I believe, and they're trying to get this bill passed in Colorado, Oregon, and California. They had about 100 people there to testify in favor of the bill, and there were about 4 people there to testify against it. But, you know, the League of California Cities wrote an amazing letter just talking about how this would create such an undue burden on cities and on law enforcement to address what could become an untenable situation in our communities. We had the Police Chiefs Association there to testify and a couple of bids. We also had a great letter writing campaign throughout the state. Now, what happened is that Senator Liu agreed to withdraw the bill temporarily and to work on amendments. And there are really no amendments that make this workable. So we actually have a meeting with her next week. Myself and the Downtown Center bid and the Historic Core bid are going to meet with her on Friday the 17th. Kind of serendipitously, the new senator that represents our area, Senator Allen, was at the chamber last week for a little meet and greet. He represents all the way from Hollywood to Santa Monica, Venice, so areas that are impacted down to Palisbury. So definitely we talked with him. So it's not over till it's over, but it's been temporarily removed. So I don't know what kind of amendments she thinks would make this feasible.
Can you tell us a little bit about this law? What is that?
It's kind of summarized, I think, in the letter for the.
It is.
Yeah. It basically says that any person would have the right to essentially live on the public right of way, parks, sidewalks, streets, alleys, for any length of time, in any number of people, with no ability for law enforcement, and it specifically says BIN agents to interfere with that behavior, otherwise it's considered harassment. And as you can see, we point out that this is number 3. The limitations on law enforcement officials, bid agents, and public or private security personnel to assist or aid individuals who are homeless will create a chilling effect on those who are often the first responders and in a position to assist. The legislation unfairly equates interactions with such personnel as harassment. In contrast, our bid control has played a key role in helping vulnerable people move from the streets and into services. And our coalition has moved 400 people off the streets.
Yeah, this is just the latest iteration of the homeless bill of rights from last year.
So what we're going to do with Carol Liu is we're bringing her pictures to show that even now we've got encampments popping up. And to, you know, Sergeant Ramos's and Captain Jarconi's point, we've seen a 56% increase in the number of homeless people in both bids over the last year. And I have an AmeriCorps worker right now that we have working with us who has gone out and she's talking to people one-on-one. Nobody is interested in coming off the streets. They are doing drugs, they are drinking alcohol, they're mentally ill. If there's someone who actually is in a position to get a job or, you know, move into that course of action, that can be done. They can get into the house shelter, we can work with them, they can save up money for an apartment. So we have a lot of people hanging out right now who are finding it rather comfortable. They're getting money from passersby. They've got their tents. They've got a complete encampment on Homewood at night. There is no incentive for them to move away.
And Perry, one of the things you brought up before is the youth that finds that a desirable lifestyle.
Right, and the solution is, turning homeless that are mentally ill into permanent assisted housing. And those, and the people partying on the streets every night, I don't think it's, they're not looking for the right to rest. They just want to party. And that's a huge negative impact on, on the rest of the community. So I personally don't think this bill is what, you know, it's a classic example of legislation that's called something completely different than really what it is. And it's the same as, it's just another iteration of what they tried to do last year. You know, the real solution is to get the people that need help, and then they get the people that really just want to go tear it up, you know, not to facilitate their lifestyle in that manner.
Yeah, we actually have a Hollywood Forward Coalition here in Hollywood, so we're going to have a little retreat on Monday downtown, and everyone is noticing the increase in homelessness all throughout LA City, and possibly throughout LA County. We'll know when official numbers come out to us. But it is worrisome because there's just a new wave of people who are coming. So we're going to be talking about some of these issues on Monday. I know Maggie Dillers will be there bringing the LAPD perspective. It's a confluence of many things that are happening right now, including some of the legislative changes and the Latin piece, the court piece, that has created a chilling effect on knowing when you can take this private property off the streets. But, you know, it's a source of a lot of complaints right now.
All right, any other questions, new business, comments? Meeting is adjourned. Thank you all.